was told I missed my real vocation as a preschool teacher, but I appreciate you coming back. We've got an exciting afternoon ahead of us. As you can see by the morning, some of the best parts of this conversation are the QA and the informal discussion. So we're going to have opportunity for that after the next talk. Corey and Shelly together are going to talk about the components of a comprehensive model of care and specifically doing some more conversations about medical assisted treatment. We've collected the index cards that you have given so far, and so we'll do our best to answer those questions woven into this afternoon, but make sure to get to all the questions the best we can by the end of the afternoon. So I'm going to turn it over to Corey and Shelly.
I grew up in Texas, and you can't get Tex-Mex in Michigan where I live now. And in California, you can get pretty close. It's California-Mex instead of Tex-Mex, but just avocado and black beans and rice and super awesome. All right, so the components of integrated care. So I don't have slides for this because I think that everybody here understands the baseline components that we need to deliver integrated care. So what does comprehensive mean? If we look at comprehensive, that's different than integrated, because you can have a group of integrated people that don't deliver comprehensive care. And so when we start to think about what is comprehensive, is it a disease-specific approach to issues, or is it we have all of these services that we provide within our office, or is it we have all of these services within a system of care that we can provide? And so you have to define it at all of those levels as, what do you pay for? Where does it happen? And then who does it happen from? Like, who actually delivers that service? So earlier when we were talking about the ASAM criteria, that's actually moved forward into a software package called Continuum that enables you to not only input the data that you get from your patient and help to give you a where they should go and what type of treatment they should receive, but it databases all of that information so that if you use that in a community, you can then look at that from a population health standpoint. And I think that we also should shift to thinking about the components of comprehensive care for a population and not necessarily just a person. Because none of us treat just a person. We always have a population of people that we treat, and whether that's a population of the panel that we see within the clinic, whether it's the population within the health system with which we work, or if it's the population in the city or the county or the state or whatever. So, in Michigan, we just recently regionalized our community mental health into 9 regions, 9 PIHPs, prepaid inpatient hospital plans, which then deliver care within those regions for SUD and behavioral health. So it's still a carve-out, but it's recently been regionalized. It used to be county-based. So we thought that this was going to be really, really helpful, and it was, except the crap fighting continues, right? So everybody still wants theirs. Everybody doesn't want to give up their little niche in the county. Nobody will sign a new contract. I mean, it is amazing to me how people will fight to maintain something horrible. I mean, honestly, because I'll bring that up, and I'm the SUD medical director for one of the regions, and I'll sit down, and I'll be like, who thinks we're giving awesome care? And nobody raises their hand. And who wishes we did something different? Yeah, so Shelly. Who wishes we were doing something different? Everybody will raise their hand. All right, who's ready to come up with a regional collaborative for payment with the block grant for what we do for criminal justice to treatment? No hands go up. And I'm like, well, what do you use your block grant for? Well, some stuff. You know, kind of a little here, a little there. And I look back, and they've actually left money on the table every year with block grant. For some of these counties, they don't even have the mechanism to do this. And what I find is that this all still comes back to defining very specifically what comprehensive care is. So if you understand what comprehensive care is and you have your boxes that you check when you go down, that's how you can build your payment systems, but that's also how you can make sure that all of these things are available to patients. So for addiction medicine, you need to have access to a prescriber who's educated in the medications for the treatment of addiction. And it's not just opioids, you know, so we have 3 for opioids, we got 5 for alcohol. We have a lot of them that have good meta-analysis data that will never be FDA approved because they're generics. They've been generics for years, and nobody's going to spend the $100 million to put it back through the FDA to get a generic, turned it with a new indication. A good example of this is N-acetylcysteine. Anybody heard of that drug, Mucamist? Right, so this should be a drug that's on every street corner in California, and especially Northern California, because it blocks dopamine release when you smoke weed. And so when you block the dopamine release when you smoke weed, it decreases the euphoria that you get from the THC. And when that happens, it decreases this kind of cyclical use nature that we find with that, you know, where it just kind of pops that dopamine up to want to do it again and want to do it again and want to do it again. Well, it blocks that. So in trials, good randomized control, placebo-controlled trials for this, it's decreased utilization of marijuana by 60%. So if you're going to build comprehensive care and an addiction treatment, if you don't offer that medication, or at least someone who knows it, you're not offering comprehensive care. You're offering the care that you've decided to deliver. So if we look at alcohol use disorder, we have great data, meta-analysis level data, meaning that there's been multiple publications that are well done that have been coalesced to show an effect to a population for baclofen, for gabapentin, for alcohol use disorder. Those are never going to be FDA approved for the utilization of this, and they probably, the crux of what they do is help with the sleep disorder that we know occurs with this, but then also stabilizes craving because they also tweak the GABA axis, so this little area of the brain that is responsible for some of that reflexive thought about these meds. So N-acetylcysteine, I can buy a 3-month supply on Amazon for $40. But I can't get it paid for in a payer, despite a 60% decrease in utilization of marijuana, which directed toward one of the questions that I saw reading through the cards is this cyclic vomiting syndrome that we see in patients that seems to only be responsive to Dilaudid. That's actually THC-induced gastroparesis, and that's been well documented in the GI literature and in the emergency medicine literature. And so when you get marijuana-induced hyperemesis syndrome or marijuana-induced gastroparesis, the reason that it actually gets better with an opioid, it's not specifically Dilaudid, but it generally that's the one that's given, is because it then blocks the opioid pathway, which slows down the movement of the stomach. It actually makes it worse long-term, but it helps them in the ER. So why in the world would we still give them this if it's helping them in the ER, but we know it makes it worse when they leave? Well, for the same reason we do a lot of things to people that we know make it worse when they leave. Right, because it moves it to somebody else's plate. All right? I did my job. My press candy looks awesome. I'll let theirs not be so great. So when we talk about comprehensive care, is it that you have a clinic in a system that delivers competent, evidence-based care, patient-focused and all of that, but then it's okay that you don't do a great job in the emergency department or you don't do a great job in the rest of the delivery system or your OB clinic maligns patients who come in on opioids? Is that a win? No, it's not. And so we all know this. You know, the elephant in the room is that we don't like to be told what to do as physicians, but we're at the point where we've kind of lost the ability to say, I'm in charge of me, because we've done such a poor job at policing each other. We've done such a poor job at delivering true evidence-based medicine and keeping up with it that we've put ourselves in a position now where we're going to be told what to do for 95% of what we're supposed to do, and then the other 5% will be the art of medicine. And so how do you develop a comprehensive care, pathway? I mean, that's the million-dollar question, right? Or I'm sorry, trillion-dollar question is probably the more accurate way to describe it. So if that's the case, we have the federal, state, county, local office. All of those have one thing in common. All of those have bills that they have to pay. So we have the tax formation that brings in money here, money then flows down out from the feds to the state. State has its own tax structure that comes in that then pours back out into the systems of care. And then that's then delivered to the direct delivery of care at that level. So what I would say is that there's never been a pure showcase for the old saying, you get what you pay for. Because we currently are getting what we pay for. I mapped out a value stream map of what we do for a behavioral health patient. So we did a very granular value stream map of the patient gets referred from either our community mental health, a primary care doctor, their psychiatrist, to the emergency department for a mental health disorder. And they either come by ambulance, they come by POV, they come by bus, whatever. So we mapped out all of those. And then we showed what happened in the emergency department, which they get to the emergency department, and they have to get medical clearance. So the emergency physician does an evaluation of the patient for safety and effective treatment, does a medical clearance based on that medical judgment, and then they tell the social worker that they need to be placed because they have suicidal ideation, and they need to be placed somewhere for treatment. Social worker evaluates the patient. They then call the facility. The facility calls them back and says, I need more tests for medical clearance. So after I yell at the people standing around me when I'm working in the emergency department about how stupid this is and the doctor on the other end of the line doesn't do what I do for a living and this is my whole specialty of care is safety and effective, you know, decision making in the emergency department, and who are they to tell me they need a head CT, you know? And then we go through that and I still get it because I just need him to go somewhere. So I radiate the dude's brain and then we end up, you know, finally maybe getting him. But by the time that we get that and get it back, then we're at the end of the shift, and then we have to flip to a new doctor who came on call for the mental health facility, and we started, you know, some of the process over because now I've also signed out care. Then the fun starts. Then we get them to a psychiatric facility, and then they realize a day and a half into their stay that the reason they were psychotic and suicidal was because that they were intoxicated on a substance and that their psychosis was secondary to the cocaine use disorder mixed with the benzodiazepine use disorder. Once that cleared up, they really don't have an organic psychiatric disorder. But what do they leave with? An organic psychiatric diagnosis, because otherwise they don't get paid. So they've been in for 3 days. Now they leave with bipolar 2 or schizoaffective disorder. And then now they have an SPMI diagnosis, for which they get set up for outpatient case management and a psychiatrist to see them who treats them for that with medication for which they do not actually have. Because they don't see the same psychiatrist every time that they go. They see a new one each time that they cycle through. So they have to believe the paperwork that they saw. That is horrible. I mean, that's embarrassing, actually, you know, when we look at this. And now we're in a position that we have the world's largest, you know, healthcare system. So people can say we should do what happens in Switzerland. We should do what happens there. LA is bigger than Switzerland. LA is bigger. I mean, so when you look at what we actually have as far as capacity and volume of ways to maneuver, we have three, you know, really cultural regions within the United States. And so within those regions, people are going to approach their care culturally a little differently, and they'll interpret the evidence even differently. So we don't even have the clarity of thought for that. So because we don't know the true evidence base of what we have to do, because we're having to go by gut feeling sometimes of what seems really logical, the easiest thing that we can do is, based in these regions, we can start to agree on at least what logic, you know, has. Now, logic at its base. Now, who here has taken a philosophy logic class in their lifetime? Right? Yeah, so a philosophy class in logic is math. It's not a I hope or I guess. It actually is math. It's calculus. You know, when you build an equation of your argument, and at the end of it is a logical thing. You know, A plus B equals C, so B plus A equals C. And then you can take the answer and divide that. If you do this and you do this, then you end up with B. I mean, so these are things that we can still use as systems, but it requires us to actually level set what we believe is the logic. So if we start at the basis of a comprehensive care system, it's information. Because if I have one person in an emergency department, and then I have a person in an outpatient setting, and then I have a person making a decision for payment, they all need to see the same set of information, because what they're going to tell me and what each of those people are going to come up with is their own truth. And each of their own truths is just as accurate, meaning not, because it's going to be through the lens that they see and the amount of information that they have. So if I'm seeing a patient in the emergency department, I need them admitted because they're telling me they're going to kill themselves. I might know that what they mean to say is, I just need housing for, you know, a couple of nights. I mean, I might know that. But I know if that's what I say, then they're still not going to get out of my emergency department. And so I have to say, well, they said they're going to kill themselves, and I'm concerned. And we are concerned. Nobody's not concerned. It's just a matter of, I now have to lie to the next provider. So we've actually set it up that in order to get a patient to a safe place so that they have a lower mortality rate, we have to lie to that provider. So then we lie to that provider, and then after they don't come up with a a diagnosis for mental health, then they lie to the payer because they basically said that they have bipolar II schizoaffective disorder. They don't. They have a substance use disorder that's not treated, and they still weren't referred to a substance use disorder clinic because they left with a psychiatric diagnosis. And then so we get stuck in this cycle. So information is key. So health information exchanges that are robust and capable of moving this information around for those people that are a part of the care team. We will not ever achieve a comprehensive, appropriate treatment pathway without the capability to see the information. I mean, period. We'll get kind of good at it, and we'll get a little better than we are right now, and we'll have places that do a good job, but systems will not do a good job until we actually have that information. So once we have the information, then what are the tenets of approach? Well, I've started to look at how we build interventions based on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So while that was one of the least evidence-based studies to ever come out in psychiatry, it was basically what Maslow thought about stuff. There was really no evidence base to this. It still, however, makes it easy for me to develop an FTE statement. Because if you start to look at your how many people you need to hire and at what level do you need to hire them, then what you have to find out is who you're treating and where they sit on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Because if you look at the bottom strip of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, where it's housing and safety and shelter and food, that's not a doctor. You don't need an FTE for a physician. You know, that's all community health workers and wraparound case management services. And then what do we need from a physical plant side? We need transitional housing and transportation. All right, so that's how you build a system to start here. The next level up, they actually start to think about health. They're not involved with health yet. They just think about actually feeling better because they can focus on it. So it's not escapism now. Now they're just looking at seeing how I can feel better. That one becomes very much about therapy and mild medical palliation. So palliation is something that we can also call risk reduction. You know, that's a point in which buprenorphine can stabilize their neuroaxis enough so that the rest of this stuff can be helpful and we retain them in treatment. So we're palliating them at this point, which I don't think anybody would disagree with palliative care for people who are suffering, right? The concept of that is appropriate. So as we stabilize that level of suffering, then we can move to that next level. That's where the FTE starts to involve prescribers on a pretty consistent level, where we can start to really look at what's going on in the brain, and we can start to determine how we treat that from a medical and therapeutic standpoint. The problem is that when we start to staff these things, we start at a level where the patients aren't. So we start up here and we start building a physician-centric model of care. We don't need a physician-centric model of care. We need a patient-centric model of care, which doesn't involve very many physicians at the beginning. Once you get a patient here, we're all really pretty good at what we do. It's just that when a patient's down here and we're trying to shove, you know, carb counting and short acting and ultra short acting insulin and long acting insulin down their throat, and they're like, I have like Cheetos and Funyuns. I mean, that's like my whole diet. And I don't know how many carbs are in a Funyun, but a Funyun and a Mountain Dew seems to get my blood sugar to about 600. But then if I take a long acting insulin, it goes down and I get hypoglycemic, and I'm not sure what to do. Then you eat some more Cheetos, specifically hot Cheetos, because they take a little longer to digest, I think. So there we go. Or you smoke some weed and get some gastroparesis, so you turn something that is a low glycemic, high glycemic index to a low, you know. These things balance out. But the real conversation we have to have, you know, at a local level and obviously at a federal and a state level is that you cannot build a comprehensive set of care until you actually work in a comprehensive manner. You know, so if you're going to build a jet fighter, you know, the person who's building the engine actually has to talk to the person who's going to be driving the plane. They got to talk to the pilot because they're going to want a thrust to weight ratio that's going to give them the capability. We don't want an F-35 Lightning that's going to go through about 1,000 iterations before they actually sit down in the same room and have a conversation. We all know this. We know that when we work in teams, it works better. So the basics that we need in the room. Has anybody ever read the book Scrum? Jeff Sutherland, highly recommend this book. And what this talks about is the ways that we've built things in the past as compared to how we should be building things. And really what it requires at first is everybody that it takes to actually deliver a comprehensive set of care matrix at the same table. Just at least once to be like, hey, what's up? When you see a prior auth, that's me. this face. I'm trying to do this for my patient so I can have a clear understanding. So when they say I have to, my patient has to fail methadone before I can give them long-acting hydromorphone, they need to realize that fail methadone means they're going to overdose and die. So yeah, that's a cheaper pathway. Absolutely. So we're going to save money by using that medicine in more than one way. So these are things that we have to talk about, because when we have a conversation at a table, then it becomes a human conversation. So you can talk about a comprehensive clinic, but the more that I've done this, I realize that my clinic is, you know, the small little grain of sand and the beach of sand. And when that happens, we can say, look, we do a good job, but I know my patients are not always going to be in my clinic. They're going to have to go somewhere else, and I have a 7-month waiting list. So what about those patients? You know, so when we start looking at systems of care, and right now we have almost every single person who touches the systems of care in this region and in this state in this room. So this is just, see this, if this was a really large table, that would be weird. But at the same time, we have most people in this room that can make those decisions and make those connections based on region, based on focus and scope and all of that. So that's why it becomes really important to start thinking about this in population health standpoint rather than what clinic am I going to build? Because there is no magic clinic. There's not. You know, you can integrate a methadone clinic and you can put a family medicine doctor in there and you can do that and you can even spread that model. But what about people who don't have an opioid use disorder, even really addiction, but just poorly treated co-occurring mental illness, and just kind of, they skirt that addiction. They have complicated dependence. What about the patient who has actual pain and probably needs opioids for on and off for an extended period of time, but also has this a mild addiction to another substance? Where do they live? I mean, that's the thing. So we can build things, and we can build brick and mortar where those things go, but we have to start thinking about this from a population health standpoint and how each of these pieces interconnect from an informatics standpoint, and then also from a basic understanding of what is the goal? What is the actual goal that we have for these patients at this time? And that actual goal is to improve their function and wellness. Because if you improve wellness, you improve their capability to get a job. You improve their capability to get educated. You improve their capability to get off disability. You improve their capability to not need the healthcare system except for prevention. So we start looking at this from a wellness standpoint, and that actually starts to make sense even from a criminal justice intervention. That if I have patients that I love it when they come in and they're on paper, which means that they actually have a probation officer and they have, you know, somebody with a stick that I can call and be like, you know, they pop positive on their drug screen. Can you put them in for 2 days? And I tell my patient, I would have never thought about that early in my career, right? I'm like, I'm not going to put them in jail. You know, I'm not going to put somebody in jail for a disease. And the answer is I'm not, except for 48 hours, because I need them off the street for 48 hours so I can get their brain straight so we can clean up some of the other stuff. So when we get them back out, we have an opportunity to put them on long-acting naltrexone. I mean, I use the jail as now a kind of a secondary detox house for us, for our patients, because I never can get a detox bed. So I call up and I'm like to their PO and I'm like, hey, I think, you know, and I tell the patients this too. I go, if you're straying, we're a part of a team, and the team includes the people that are holding you accountable for public safety. You know, because those are public safety officers if you use them. But we've had such a conflictual interaction over time that they don't believe us because we've lied to them a lot for the same reasons we lie to each other, like I talked about earlier. But if you use them as part of the team, then you can actually start to have criminal justice be just as much of a part of the treatment / behavior modification than we have. I mean, I don't know a better behavior modification than, I don't know, if you do this, you don't have to go to jail for 2 days. If you don't do this, you're going to go to jail for 2 days. And it's not terribly fun. And so being able to use that is better than, like, I have a movie ticket if your drug's clean, you know, if your urine drug screen's clean. Because they're like, really? That's neat, doc. I appreciate it. And so I love movies. And so we have to think about contingency management and how we approach this. So systems of care and comprehensive modalities of treatment are not about a clinic, are not about an intervention, are not about a new payment. It's not about a waiver. It's about how those things interact with the other systems that actually already do work relatively well, and finding out which ones those are, building onto them, but actually building onto them in a connected way. So how many people here really feel comfortable with understanding 42 CFR Part 2? Right? Everybody's favorite one. So I wrote a chapter on this recently, and it drove me insane because I had to read everything about it and all these things. And when I wrote it, what I found is that the government doesn't even know what 42 CFR Part 2 means. because it was written in 78, and then actually the regulations dropped in 86. And then when they dropped in 86, they haven't been changed. But in 86, they still didn't know what an addiction treatment facility was. So that how that information moves. Am I an addiction treatment facility? I mean, we don't take referrals based on addiction. We have some people there and I treat it. So who labels that? Do I have to actually hold to 42 CFR Part 2? I don't know. My risk lawyer will always say yes. You know, they'll come in and say, oh, no, you can't have any of this information go anywhere. And I'm like, it's already on Epic, man. I don't know what to tell you. It's all there. And then I always laugh. I go, what about tobacco use disorder? We're mandated to actually report that, yet that's an addiction. So does everybody who reports tobacco use disorder at the mandated piece of HEDIS and CMS actually breaking 42 CFR Part 2 because they're talking about an addiction to somebody else outside of the system? I mean, this is stuff that's just weird, right? You know, so all we need to do is we just need to get Burwell and her group to just write a memo clarifying. I mean, that's it. I mean, it sounds really simple. And, you know, why doesn't that happen? Because 25 or 30 states don't stand up and write letters that say, we need this clarification next week. And then they go crisis to crisis to crisis. They love it when they're told what we need. I mean, I spend a lot of time in D.C., and if everybody in this room came together on a letter that was co-signed by Southern California, I mean, in California is, the seventh largest freestanding economy on the planet? So we look at it as how we sit in the state, but if you look at it as where we sit on the planet, I mean, this state has some financial prowess that has the capability to be like, this is what we need. And so you should utilize that strength. You know, we have less people in Michigan than in LA County. We have 9.6, 9.7 million people. You know, so that's a different problem than LA County. You know, when my patient's going to be like, well, if you just come down the 405, you're going to be fine. And they're like, I'll see you next week. You know, so trying to figure out how these things work together are the fundamental aspects of what is a comprehensive treatment package. And that is the ability for someone to come in and improve their function and wellness based on whatever disease it is. We still have to find out where they are in the life, you know, Maslow's hierarchy. So a well-designed system that is comprehensive will always evaluate that first, whether it's a cardiologist, an endocrinologist, an orthopedic surgeon. Because if somebody smokes two packs a day and gets a hip replacement, their chances of going back in the hospital within 30 days are 50 times that of somebody who doesn't smoke. So why is an orthopedic surgeon not working on why is there not an addictionist embedded into ortho? I mean, honestly, because the people that we end up spending a ton of money on, if you look at lower back revisions, the failure rate is directly proportional to the portion of people who were on opioids when they showed up and smoking tobacco. So the two things that are most predictive of failure in orthopedic surgery are addiction related. What are the three biggest costs in our system? Obesity, alcohol use disorder, and tobacco use disorder. Those are the three biggest, you know, indicators of cost. Now, anybody who's followed the addiction literature over the last year, we now have good data to show that for a number of patients, almost all of those that are super morbid obese, and definitely those that skirt higher obesity, glucose has the same reaction on the brain as does alcohol, as far as what it does for release of dopamine in the nucleus accumbens. So for them, glucose is no different than alcohol. So really, the top three most expensive things in the country are addiction related. Sure. All right, so we're going to do the 10-minute addiction talk. It used to be an hour, and then I got another 30 minutes, and it's 12. I've been able to get it down to 10. All right, so we need three things to survive, right? You need food, you need water, you need dopamine. All right, so you need dopamine to actually get out of bed in the morning to go get food and water. Dopamine is required to actually create that emotional connection between two people. It's that thing that makes you love your children and that mother-baby bond and the thing that, you know, makes you do a better job when somebody pats you on the back and said you did a good job. So that is required to be released in this area of the brain called the nucleus accumbens. So, which is also the final common pathway for all addiction is the nucleus accumbens. It all sits right there. So on a normal day, we actually know how much dopamine is released in the nucleus accumbens, about 50 nanograms per deciliter, 50 nanograms per deciliter on a regular day. And that allows us to get up and get to the coffee machine and go to work and be like, oh, I love my job, it's awesome. And then you just get through it and you come home and your worst day ever, the day that you've, you know, call in and you like fake vomit on the phone so you don't have to show up, and you know, you're just like, I can't make it. And you stay in there in your pajamas all day, or you just go sit at the beach and you do nothing and you stare at the sky. You know, that's 40 nanograms per deciliter, all right? Best day ever. Win the lottery, 2% body fat, sitting on a beach, it's like all perfect, yeah. That's 100 nanograms per deciliter. That's the highest our brain is physiologically built to have. At that point, we can still risk assess, we can still evaluate the things around us and make good decisions, but we're happy. We're like really happy at that point. So best food ever, which we've tested in functional MRIs, about 94. Sex is about 92. Bummer, right? So I'm hoping that there's some research variability within that number, but I haven't seen the follow-up studies. But when we look at this, so we're really meant to live between 40 and 100. You know, worst day, best day, and we roam around there. Some people are always like super optimists, so they probably sit around 70 and they're like, this is great, my car's broken. You know, but I can get a new one maybe in a year and a half. So this will be awesome. You know, they just like somehow always seem to be like, everything's great. So if 100 is our maximum, what happens when somebody uses methamphetamine? It goes up to about 1,100 nanograms per deciliter. So this part of the brain that was meant at maximum to have 100 now has produced 1,100 nanograms per deciliter. And about 975 for heroin, and then we start to go down with alcohol and marijuana and, you know, all of the other drugs that fit in that, but they're all greater than 500 nanograms per deciliter. So when that happens, the body doesn't like to be told what to do. It likes homeostasis. So instead of 1,100, the next time it's going to be 1,000, then 900, then 500, then 300, then 200, then about 150 for meth. And maybe about 120 for heroin, maybe about 110 for alcohol when you're inebriated. So what happens when we take them off? So they've re-regulated after being on this for a period of time. Now all of a sudden you have somebody who's re-regulated down here. We take away the substance that had been maintaining that dopamine, and now what do we got? Well, best it feels like zero, but best day ever at this point, 20 nanograms per deciliter. Average day, about 12 to 15 nanograms per deciliter, and less than 10 is that worst day. That's when they don't even physically get out of bed. Because the focal aspect of what we have to do in the morning is motivate to get out of bed, right? You know, this morning when it was 4:45 your time, which was, you know, 6:45 my time, I'm wide awake and I'm like, oh, but I have this opportunity to actually sleep. And no, I just had to get up. And, you know, that motivation to get up and get something done is a hard thing to get at that time in the morning, but we can do it. But when you don't have the chemical that's responsible for motivation, then everything that we ask for a patient requires motivation. They don't have the chemical capability to do that. So if the body requires dopamine in order to obtain food and water, and we know that people will do some crazy stuff for food and water, right? If you're starving or if you're dying of dehydration, I mean, you'll, like if I walked across the desert and there's like a big glass of water and there's somebody in front of me says, can't have that water. I'd be like, oh, stab, stab. And I would take the water. I mean, they would totally get shivved right there. And I would take the water and I'd be like, that's awesome. And you know, it would be great. And at that time it would make perfect sense. But after I kind of got hydrated, I'd be like, oh, that was, wow. That's really not a behavior I thought I would ever do. But we see this time after time with starvation in countries that have famine, and this people will revert to a very primal state. So if dopamine is required to even desire and motivate to get food and water, what if we don't have dopamine? So this started to, you know, for me as a neuroscientist, really started to help me to understand why we see the behaviors that, you know, really make patients frustrating, but then also define the disease. So when we look at this, if you don't have dopamine, and the only thing that you can do to get dopamine is the drug, and without dopamine, you can't even eat or drink, the survival of this has to be pretty strong, right? Well, we've actually done some studies on this, and Apkarian up in Northwestern, and then also L.A. Gardner at the NIDA, National Institute on Drug Addiction, did studies where they looked at the differential craving between water, food, and drugs. And so on functional MRI, so if you take away some water for 3 days, So no liquids for 3 days, and you put somebody in a functional MRI, and then you talk, have them talk about waterfalls, and you play water sounds, and you like sprinkle water on their feet, and then you have them take a glass of water, and they show, you get a relative activation of the craving centers, which we know, they're the anterior cingulate gyrus, the lateral bed nuclei of the amygdalae, and then also the lateral prefrontal cortex. I mean, these are places that we can see light up, you know, on this functional MRI. So they light up about the relative size of a baseball. And then you do that for food. So 5 days, no food. And then you have them talk about their favorite food, and you make it, you're like wafting it into the MRI tube that they're smelling it, and then they taste it, and you look at their brain, and then that person has a relative size of craving in these areas about the size of a basketball. Then you do this with a person who has been 90 days clean or 1 year clean. And I'm just gonna skip the 90 days clean, because what we find is that 1 year later, you're exactly the same. So at 1 year, you put somebody in an MRI, and you ask them to talk about, you know, their the drug that they had used, the first time they had used, and the last time they had used. Those were the questions that they used. And the relative size of craving in those areas was the size of a baseball field. So when you have someone who's going to die of starvation, and you have someone who's going to die of dehydration, and they do crazy stuff, imagine if you multiply that by tenfold in that desire. All of a sudden, you're completely locking down the frontal lobe. So they even saw a signal degradation in the frontal lobe by almost 70%. So that high-level thinking required to plan is gone. There's no planning. It is very much id, and I need this right now for survival. And so understanding that allows us to begin to understand why these behaviors happen, because they really feel and have this internal drive like they are gonna die. That they are not going to survive. And so when we say that they lied to me, wah. I mean, that's like the basic survival skill, is them fibbing about their back pain. You know, oh, it's horrible. I don't know what I'm going to do. And then we're like, oh, my goodness, here's more Dilaudid. And let's, you know, here's more pills. And I mean, it's just like we just give it over. And so why would they, you know, behaviorally do something else? So if this lack of dopamine is really the basis for what we're dealing with, and it actually explains a lot about the mood disorder we find in SUD, because if you have low dopamine, we call this an anhedonic state, and anhedonia is very much a flat affected depression. What do you think they hear when their dopamine is that low when they're sitting in therapy? Here's your prescription. That's it. I mean, that's it. So unless we stabilize the dopamine axis in these patients, then we get no benefit from all this money that we're spending on therapy. Which is why what we find in the patients that we treat in the publicly funded sector is a complete and utter failure from abstinence-based programs. This is where we have to separate the two cohorts. If you take a patient who's a doctor or a pilot or you know, a lawyer, people who have already gone through high school and college and extra training, and then they have their use disorder, that's a completely fundamentally different brain than the person who started using at 14. And created those maladaptive connections in these areas of the brain all the way from 14 until whenever we see them. Because that's about the average age of onset of use of drugs on a consistent pathway for those in the publicly funded sector. If you look at the privately funded sector, which is where the vast majority of 12-step abstinence-based programs were researched, these are people who have natural dopamine capability. They have family. They have support systems. They actually didn't destroy the structure in their brain that creates dopamine, because they didn't start till later in life and it's pretty well solidified. They have massive contingency management programs. So if you're an impaired provider, for 5 years you have to call after every night and find out if you got to pee in a cup in the morning. And if you do, you're going to lose your license. That's some pretty solid contingency management. That's even better than 2 days in jail if you drive dirty. So for us to take that literature and then somehow feel like that's an appropriate, you know, comprehensive package of treatment for the patients that we treat in the public sector, whose brain is fundamentally different. It is a different chronic neurobiological disorder at this time. And by looking at the amount of dopamine that is capable of being released in patients with consistent use from adolescence on, it is a fundamentally different brain than those people who started later in life. So it's a chronic neurobiological disorder, and at its base is a lack of dopamine. A lot of other stuff around that for each other drug. We won't go into that neuroscience. I love it, but it's after lunch and we just had some Mexican food, so that might get a little old. But when we look at that, if we replace that dopamine so that therapy can start to work, At that point, we have the capability to then have them change the behaviors that then were really fundamentally about survival for them. It wasn't about, I just wish I could be better. It wasn't, I'm making a bad decision because I risk evaluated it and thought about it. So building a system of care requires exactly what we talked about, information sharing. If you treat addiction and you don't know that fundamental aspect of the neuroscience of addiction, are you providing a knowledge-based, comprehensive delivery care system? No, because we're treating behavior and not the cause of the behavior. So some patients who hadn't used for that long, we can actually replace dopamine, do therapy, wean off the medication, dopamine then naturally replenishes, and then they can go on about their life, and they can maintain that level of behavior and be functionally fine. Some patients require a little longer time frame for that to happen, and we can slowly wean and get them off 5 to 7 years later. First group is about 18 months. You shouldn't even start thinking about weaning for 18 to 24 months, because the data is very clear that it takes that for that long before you can even start to recapture basic dopamine levels. So I don't even talk to our patients, you know, for 18 months to 24 months before we even talk about weaning. But then there are some patients who started very early who used it such a high level that instead of not releasing dopamine or not producing as much dopamine, they actually then kill off the cells responsible for making the dopamine. And then that is no different than having a stroke in the area of the brain in the limbic system. So they're never going to reproduce that amount of dopamine. These are the patients who have permanent anhedonic depression. It's not a cry-in-the-corner depression like a serotonin depression. This is a dopamine-based depression, and this is about they can't be high or low. Yeah, so the question is how does an SSRI fit into addiction therapy? There's no evidence to show that an SSRI by itself has any positive effect on outcomes for addiction. However, if you find and treat a serotonin-based co-occurring disorder, then it can be very helpful. This is the sad cry-in-the-corner depression, you know, from a clinical perspective. A flat affected dopamine-dependent depression is your car's on fire. All right. Here's $100. Cool. It's your kid's birthday. I mean, they just don't have the ability to actually muster. Now, on the outside, they'll put together the facial expressions they know, or they'll fake cry. And, you know, I always, you know, for our best fake criers in our office, whenever they do it, I'm just like, oh, that was, wow, super awesome. That was so good. Wow, can you just do that again? Like, can you start it like that? Because I'm so impressed. But having, you know, the ability to actually create a real emotion requires this dopamine axis to be working appropriately. So without that, if you don't get that stabilized at some level, which is why there's now a, they just finished phase three trials, a buprenorphine-based antidepressant, which is a 2 milligram long-acting version of buprenorphine that would be taken as an antidepressant, specifically for anhedonic depression, not serotonin-based depression. You know those ones who are the patients who are refractory to SSRIs and SNRIs? It's because it's dopamine. Now, Wellbutrin can be helpful, bupropion, because that actually centrally activates some dopamine, and you can use that, but it has a lot of side effects for anxiety. And most of my patients already have pretty bad anxiety, which is also natural history of this disease, right? So if you're in a house with a lot of early life trauma, when the car door closes and the person who's going to beat the crap out of you that day shows up, you start to get some pretty pathological anxiety when you hear the car door close. That's really protective early on. It makes you go clean your room or do the things you need to do and hide or whatever. So that's very protective, and it's appropriate. So you've now, you know, created a wonderful equilibrium for that situation. But the minute that you're out of that house, it's now pathology. So I give somebody bupropion who had this early life trauma, and I exacerbate their anxiety. A lot of our patients who use these meds, and we have a lot of patients who now come to our system purely based on the fact that they got a hold of buprenorphine on the street and said, this is the first time I felt normal. And they want to come in and get it prescribed, which is weird, right? So I'm having to, like, congratulate a patient for doing something illegal, and I'm glad that they're here. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, who wasn't paying attention to their prescribing habits so that all their meds were being diverted? Because this is a real issue. And this is the thing that gets us emotionally connected to building these systems of care, because for this disease, we have an abnormal emotional connection to the medication-assisted treatment, specifically the two that are most available to raise dopamine early on, which is methadone and buprenorphine. This emotionally connected pathway is pervasive throughout all health policy. Like, why in the world, if we have a medication that shows that we can decrease the mortality rate of a patient by up to 85% with an opioid use disorder on buprenorphine, why would we put a one-year limit on that? Why would we have a one-year limit on a medication that with plenty of randomized controlled trials that show that for the population that we treat, that if you stop it too early, that relapse is going to happen? That abstinence-based therapy is 95% ineffective in this group at 1 year. That medication-assisted treatment with appropriate behavioral therapies, cognitive behavioral therapy, dialectical behavioral therapy, motivational enhancement therapy, are 85% effective in this group. I mean, these are just numbers that keep coming up and coming up and coming up to the point where it's not a guess anymore. We just know it. And so when we're building a comprehensive wraparound service package for patients, if it doesn't include these things, you're just not doing it. It may make you feel good. We built a better clinic with cool bricks and a nice fireplace. You know, but at the end of the day, if you don't offer the medications that are available and known to be helpful, that are FDA approved, and as much as you may, you know, agree or disagree with some of the FDA stuff, it's a hard place to get meds through. I mean, it's not like the European version of the FDA, which only has to look at safety. It doesn't even look at efficacy. So this is, you know, ours looks at safety and efficacy. Where it falls down is how we handle these patients on the outside with multiple prescriptions, because the vast majority of side effects we see for a medication happen because they've now been written in the setting of 10 different medications at one time, which we just can't evaluate. So in looking at if we're gonna build a good system of care, does that mean that we have to do, you know, is it appropriate for patients who are gonna be treated for mental health and a substance use disorder or a pain disorder or all of the above, should we be doing pharmacogenetic testing? And if so, who should be doing it? It's not generally doctors. If I ask a basic question of most of my doctor friends, you know, what does the 2D6 do? They're gonna be like, on my Audi? I don't know what you mean. Is that like a new car? No, I mean, so this needs to be something that pharmacists should own. I mean, they're the ones who understand this data more than anybody, so why aren't the pharmacists able to, you know, to order a test when they find a high-risk patient on multiple medications that have some side effects? You know, so these are comprehensive, appropriate ways that we look at treatment, and these are not far from reach. We have FDA-approved medications for opioid use disorder. We have FDA-approved medications for alcohol use disorder. We have medications with good meta-analysis data. And now we actually have really good data for the behavioral health interventions. And it's not even just specifically which one, but how often and how much. So on the website for CHCF, I gave you guys the medication-assisted treatment guidelines for opioid use disorders in Michigan. So I wrote those, and they were adopted, I guess, in 2014. And what one of the chapters that I put in there specifically was a utilization management chapter. So how do you decide, using the ASAM criteria as a part of how we built it and that, but if they have mild, moderate, or severe disease with a co-occurring, what does that look like? But we now know how to dose behavioral therapy. So if you do IOP, we know that intensive outpatient management, we know that that very high acuity interaction is really helpful. Do you still need that high acuity at a year? No. What do you do when you just do once a month therapy and you pay for it once a month for a 45-minute session? Nothing. You're burning cash. Just set it on fire. It's more fun. Because that's exactly what you're doing. There's no evidence behind it. But when we mandate monthly one-on-one therapy sessions in a methadone clinic for somebody who's been on a stable dose of methadone with improved function at year 5, that is wasted money. The next question is, do they still need to be on methadone to maintain that level of a function? If you're going to wean them down 1 milligram a week for eternity, they'll never get off, because what they're going to do is find out that something bad happens in their life, because that's what happens when you're in a methadone clinic, is you're not generally connected to a whole lot of organizations in life that don't have some problems along the time frame. Then what'll happen is you'll get down by 60 or 70 milligrams, and things actually seem to be going okay, but then all of a sudden there'll be some problem that happens in their life with housing or stability or a relationship, and then they crank up that dose of med again because I can't get the dose of behavioral health cranked up and paid for. So these are things we have to start thinking about if we develop these delivery models of care. You know, I have a PowerPoint that I use for these, but I've done it enough to where it's I find that it's useless, because what it does is it gives you specific points, but the reality is that unless you're going to look at this overhaul system, then what we're going to have is a malalignment of what we're paying for versus what we want. And if we look at this, there are many areas in which we can change where that payment goes. We have the federal level, like we talked about. We have the state level. We have the county level. And then we have different buckets. And we talked about all the different buckets that we had this to look for. But if we can all agree on using evidence as the basis for the way in which we develop policy and payment, and we remove the emotion from that, then that's going to get us to the point where we can actually deliver appropriate, real comprehensive care and not this figmented, make-me-feel-better version of it. Because in my clinic, we deliver a large amount of really good care, but I don't have access to methadone in my clinic. I have to send them out to go get methadone. So I'm not delivering the comprehensive care that I need to. If I have SPMI and SUD, I don't have a psychiatrist in my clinic. I mean, we do the best we can, but the best we can is not best, you know? And that's a reality. If I have a patient with brittle diabetes, they're going to get decent care, but they're not getting the best care. You know, we're still all stuck in this, what can I do with the least amount of stuff pathway? And that's fine. Developing a system based on scarcity, like we talked about, can actually be a helpful way to fix some problems that are there. But we know best practice. We know best practice for endocrinology, for hypertensive treatment, for addiction treatment, for behavioral health treatment. For all of these things, for orthopedic treatment. But yet, we know that if you do a translaminar L3-4 spinal injection for chronic lumbar spine pain, it is placebo. We still pay for that. A few $100. How much do I get paid to go see a patient in a hospital? And this is pretty consistent throughout all states that have carve-outs. If I'm asked to go to the hospital, evaluate a patient who's in polysubstance withdrawal, in the ICU and is also septic, and I spend 2.5 hours, you know, helping figure out what's going on and which medicines they need to be on and how we stabilize the neurochemistry and how we get this set up, that gets reimbursed $0 if they're a Medicaid patient. Zero. If I walk into that same patient and I write them for Norco, they can be septic and, you know, be laying there with a blood pressure of 90, and I could write them for Norco, and that reimburses right at around $122. We get what we pay for. So this is, you know, you wonder why hospital systems don't develop robust addiction treatment inpatient pathways in a hospital system, because they can't. I mean, it's free, at that point. And so being able to construct something inside of a hospital when you have 60% of your patients that meet for a substance use disorder, especially in trauma centers. I mean, in LA County, the percentage of people, you know, with an addictive disorder inpatient is no different than the number of, you know, that have an SUD is no different than the number of people with an SUD that are incarcerated in LA County Jail. I mean, we know these numbers, we say them over and over again. We quote them, we show the papers, we look at it. So the comprehensive system of care is something that takes all of that data and puts it together, not in a single clinic, but in a system of care. So that seems really big, right? Like, and we can't do that. But the answer is, what can we do? So if we know what best practices are here and best practices are there, what you can do is you can build the individual clinic sites that deliver care to those groups of patients that are at risk with those best practices and then interconnect those. And then interconnecting those contractually allows you to circumvent the information problem because they're contractually connected. And as soon as you're contractually connected as an entity, whether or not you're getting paid through the same mechanisms or not, you can now share even 42 CFR level data within those entities. So if you deliver addiction care and you deliver behavioral health care and you deliver comprehensive multimodal polymedical care, you should all be connected. And you can connect it just based on a one-off contract. It doesn't have to be some massive entity. I mean, it's basically a shared, you know, patient, you know, contract. So that way you have one release. Everybody signs the same release in that place. And you sign the release that says, you know, you pick a doctor at each of those places. So if you just have three places and you have one doctor that you say can receive my addiction information, even if you are an addiction facility, it meets 42 CFR Part 2, which states that a patient can release information to a specific practitioner. Pretty soon it may actually say can release information to a specific practitioner, a health system, or health information exchange. I've had that talk's happened like 4 times in the last 6 months in DC, and I think that's actually gonna happen. There's nothing like a lame duck president at the end of their term to get a whole bunch of this really unpalatable stuff done. So I think we're going to be able to see a lot of these things, you know, happening, you know, as we get closer. But right now, you can do it even without worrying about if the feds are going to handle it. And removing the emotion from the treatment requires just understanding the data. If you just understand the data and you say, look, we define this based on behavior, so we need to see behavior as a symptom, not as a frustration. And if we all just agree that that's the case, then your PAM scores are going to go up. Whatever you decide to use, your PAM scores, your PHQ-9s, your GAD-7s, your complication index, you know, whatever Apache scores for trial. I mean, whatever it is you want to score, we can score it, and they'll go up, and they'll get better, except for the Apache, which we want to go down. But as we look at those different things, whatever endpoint you want to meet, if we have a collaborative information sharing approach to care that uses evidence, that's it. So if you fund an integrated clinic that deals, you know, fundamentally more with behavioral health than SUD, that's fine. But then make sure they're directly connected with somebody who has a best practices approach to the delivery of substance use disorder care so they can work together. And then absolutely make sure that they work together with a medical home so that these patients can get flu shots and Pneumovax and, you know, STD treatment and hepatitis C and HIV evaluations and treatment. Because addiction care really should encompass all of those things, but it rarely does. So hopefully I've taken in more from the severe abstract to at least some relatively ground level pathways. And again, the guidelines are in the are on the website, and those are adopted by the state of Michigan, and we're about to come out with version 2. And these are nationally, sadly enough, the only integrated treatment guidelines that include behavior and medication-assisted treatment for all three medications, methadone, buprenorphine, naltrexone, as well as all the different modes of treatment, the wraparound services that should go. And people always ask me, God, do you use any 12-step? Absolutely. That's one of the best things for phase 3 of treatment, which is stabilization and maintenance and you know, reduction of long-term risk, because it's a group of people wanting to stay clean or sober. And there's nothing better than that kind of support long-term. And so do I use it? Yeah. I just don't use it up front. And then when we do use it, it becomes really effective and people do latch onto that. So you can use a lot of these things that we have a lot of knowledge built around and a lot of emotional context, but it has to be placed in the right time frame of the disease. Because I don't give you an antibiotic before you have an infection. I don't replace your heart valve thinking you're going to get a growth on it later. You know, this is not how we do it. You dose it at the right time and at the right amount, and those are the times in which you can actually start to make a difference. So there were a lot of questions. I mean, a lot of them. So I actually want to make sure we leave. I think so, because I think they're good, and I didn't see any I haven't seen before, which is a good sign. They're always a little different for specific states. So if you wanted to.
Dive tomorrow. We'll do a deeper dive tomorrow when you go into the model, but I think having a high level understanding would be good. What does your team do with a patient when they're admitted to the hospital? Do you see them in the hospital, or how do you communicate with the inpatient team?
Generally, most of this can be handled telephonically because, you know, just ask them some basic things and they'll go back and get the information. If I feel like the patient is getting poor treatment because everybody's just not talking or that, then I'll go see them in the hospital. I generally don't go see them just for capability of time and ability, but you can do most of this from building guidelines. So we built a pre- and post-operative pain treatment guideline for the hospital. I've rebuilt the entire alcohol detox protocol for the hospital and moved away from benzodiazepines and more into other modalities. And then really just am always trying to be nice to the hospital when they call, no matter what time of the night or day it is. Because if I mean that they're actually, that whole emotion gets flipped around to my patient, and I know that, so there are times in which I have to just like, and have a phone call about, hey, thanks so much for calling. I always try to turn it into a teaching event, you know, at least for a little bit, even a couple, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, it's probably not very good teaching. It's like, why do donuts have holes in the middle? Do you understand that? You know, it's like whatever I can think of to teach, but I think you can handle most of it by telephone.
So can you just say briefly, what kind of dose do people get with for first appointment? How long is the appointment? How often do you see them? What's the follow-up? How many patients per half day do the medical providers see? Just high-level overview.
Sure. So if you look at the way that we've now gotten to our system, and this is not how it started. This is after multiple iterations of screwing it up and it not working and and that. So what we found now that seems to work is a dosing model that the initial visit is 2.5 to 3 hours. That allows us to get all the paperwork filled out, allows for an in-depth evaluation from social work, and a pretty good high-level first major problem set for patients. Now, we define medical problems as anything that impacts your ability to be well. So we let the patient tell us what their number one medical problem is. And so sometimes it's my car doesn't work, and that's fine, because that's a medical problem to us. If you don't have a refrigerator, that's a medical problem. If you don't have a place to live, that's a medical problem. So we deal with it in the order in which the patient wants to deal with it. If they come in and say, today, the biggest thing that I have to have dealt with is my pain, we deal with it, much in the same way that I talked about earlier. We get them on a safer version of the medication, because when they come in, that usually means, and they complain about that first, that usually means they've been on an opioid up and down. So that first visit becomes really helpful for retention. And then after that first visit, we then see them weekly for 6 weeks, and then every other week for 8 weeks. And then if everything has gone well, which it never does, then we would go out to monthly. But we end up going back and forth a little bit for patients, and that may come back to weekly. It may go out to 2 weeks for a while and then back. It depends on what urine drug screens show. Everybody pees when they hit the door, so we do a full comprehensive evaluation toxicologically when they come in, meaning we do an immunoassay point of care test. And then we send it off for a GC mass spec, a comprehensive, so that I know everything that's in the system. But then we generally only do point of care testing after that, unless they're refuting a finding. So unfortunately, toxicology is like a vital sign in addiction medicine, but it's been abused immensely against payers. And so people will, you know, get these really expensive tests when they don't need it. I mean, my patients now, when we sit down and have a conversation, they know that we're going to check it. I'm sorry, so what am I going to find in your pee when we check it? They just tell me. I don't even have to check it in most of our patients after that, because they know I'm not going to fire them. They're just going to tell me, and we're going to change course based on that, and we'll have a conversation. They feel guilty, and they're frustrated. They don't like it. And so once you get there, that conversation saves us a tox screen. What may happen is I say, you know, we've been going every two. Maybe we slide it back a little bit and just see you weekly for a couple more weeks and see what's going on. They almost always agree with that. They don't get frustrated with us wanting to see you more often. So that's pretty much how we dose it. And then if they have a relapse or a behavioral health relapse, then we collapse back down to increasing visitation time frame, not necessarily increasing dose of medications.
So this is a question that each of you probably should answer. What kind of training do you need to give your medical staff in terms of addiction and pain? And then for your behavioral health staff, what kind of training do you see as core for someone who's starting with the program new?
This is all Shelly, because she does all that training for us.
For medical, the training that I do with them a lot is trauma-informed care. Understanding how trauma impacts people, behavior, all of that. And especially for MAs, I do de-escalation training and how to not only de-escalate themselves, but de-escalate patients, and a lot of self-care. And that goes for medical too. Medical it's important for self-care.
I think that's important to drill down on, because, you know, for anybody who works in this field, burnout is huge, and the ability to do this, you can't rely on somebody who has the almost Aspergerish capability to turn off the emotion. You need to, you know, actually know how you know when you need a break, when you don't need a break. You need to kind of force vacation sometimes, allow for appropriate dark humor when it's not maligning patients directly, but the concept of things. I always talk about, if somebody walks into one of our meetings and didn't catch the beginning, which were always very much, what are we doing, what's the dose, and how do we do this, and what do we have to do with patients? And towards the end, it always breaks more down into, what's the best line you've heard for why I lost my meds this week, you know, and you know, who gets the award for, you know, most ridiculous thing. But, and that kind of interaction becomes really important. But then from a very practical standpoint, if I have a patient that comes in that is scheduled to see me, but I am not actually emotionally prepared to see this patient today, I don't. I have a therapist see them, and I just write their prescriptions.
Right.
I mean, it's just, you have to be able to do that.
You have to be able to, and I think behavioral health is a much better advantage on that, because we get training in it, or we should in our social work programs. Nursing and PAs and Ps, physicians, they don't. And so that's a really important piece of understanding this population and taking care of yourself and being able to identify that in other your coworkers too, being able to say you need to go home and run, or buy a treadmill and stop whining because you hate treadmills.
Shelly, can you? It seemed when I talked to you before that people trained in social work in Michigan get a pretty broad training both on the addiction side and the mental health side. Can you tell a little bit about what the pipeline of social workers coming out of the system and then what you have to remediate?
Yeah. So the social work is a national. It has national guidelines as far as what is required in a social work program, and anyone here who has their master's in social work knows that. Michigan, some of our schools do a great job of training in addiction, or at least making sure that people have addiction classes. Some of those addiction classes are taught by someone who's still reading literature from the 1970s. So it's a work in progress. I think because our state has basically converged mental health and substance use into one entity on the public side, that there's a lot more training in mental health and substance use disorder. When I first started in the field, it was completely siloed, like it is in the state. You were either a mental health clinician or an addiction professional. Now it's both. So I think that works to a bigger advantage when working in integrated care. But one of the bigger trainings that I do a lot with our staff that comes in are interns, and then I also have been working a lot with our primary care section of our system in training social work that's being embedded in primary care, is actually learning how to work within a medical setting. That's not a training we get in social work. I mean, we may get some information on integrated care, depending on how young you are. When I was in social work, my master's program, integrated care was like holistic care with like evidence-based care, maybe. But there was no primary care and social work or behavioral health care. Now, it's a bigger push, but really, if you're a behavioral health professional, it's a whole different skill set. Like learning how to talk to a physician, learning how to do a case presentation, we are really, 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 really wordy. And after about 5 seconds, they tune us out. So learning how to present a case in two minutes, and it seems easy, but it's not. Like, how do you pick out the data you need? And so learning how to work together is a huge piece, and then they have to learn to tolerate us because we are a little bit more wordy. But learning how to get your point across, learning like medical terminology. Yeah. Thank you.
No, but that's a
dosing.
But that's important.
Meds.
So don't gloss over that, because the vast majority of master's level social workers don't learn buprenorphine. They don't know that word, even though it's an actual part of the treatment. Coming right out of school, and so people that have worked in the field get it, and they understand, you know, these things. But, you know, what is buprenorphine? What is naltrexone? What are the general doses? Not that you have to prescribe it, but you need to know that the highest dose that you should be prescribing in the evidence base is 24. So if you see doctors that are writing everybody for 32 milligrams, they're not following evidence. If you see a bunch of people writing 2 milligrams right out of the gates, they're also not following evidence. So just being able to learn that, and all of our social workers know that, for them to understand the general approach to using opioids for pain. You want a long-acting med with breakthrough medication. Is breakthrough once, like, every 6 hours? No, it's once. It's like 10 days out of every month. That's how breakthrough should be treated. So
once every 4 hours?
Or 1.5 to 2, yeah.
Understanding the neurobiology of it all, too. So yeah. So that's the other piece. In social work, we don't get a lot of medical training. We don't get a lot of core science classes. And as a result, it's a lot harder for us to understand these things. Now, neurobiology happens to be something I'm really interested in. I suck at chemistry, so I went the social work road. But this aspect of addiction has always been the most interesting to me, and so I've had human physiology and neurobiology of addictive drugs. But how many people who have went through their master's in social work have had those classes? You know,
it's okay, all
one. Yeah, but if you don't understand that, it's really hard to understand these disease processes. both for behavioral health and medical.
So I'm going to go through the ones on questions, and then we'll go to the floor. So I think I want to answer this first, which is I'm hoping the answer is yes, but here's the question. You have built such a strong system with loyal staff. Is it transferable? How much of the magic sauce is you two versus the systems?
No, this has been an issue from the beginning. And so this was brought up the first day that we sat down to have a meeting about building this clinic within the system. Is I don't want to build a clinic based on a person. And I'm like, well, that's really funny since you do that for orthopedics and you do that for, you know, a headache specialist and you do that for interventional pain specialist. You just don't want to do it for addiction. What? And so I didn't say that. That's what I thought. But I said, you know, you're right. Because that's the first step of behavioral modification is thinking they're right. So, so, you know, we've been working based off the hit by the bus phenomenon. What happens if I get hit by the bus? And I mean, what happens with that? Well, honestly, you know, what happens, you know, if I get fired, because I try all the time for that, and sooner or later, it's gonna catch at some point. But so what happens? Because I worry about what's gonna happen to the patient. So as we've built this, we've actually built it systematically so that we can know that anybody who walks into this clinic knows the pathway that you see the patient, the information that you gather, and this and that. And this is best shown by the fact that I see patients on average in a month 4 days.
And when Corey's in the office, it usually creates more chaos.
Yeah. And so that means that we've had a clinic with the hardest patients in an entire health system being seen by two PA teams. Period. I mean, I'll see my buprenorphine patients once a month just to make sure that my DEA buddies are all happy. But the reality is my PAs are perfectly capable of handling modulation of a dose of buprenorphine because legally they can write oxy. You know, so it's some of these legal hurdles that have been put there. And they get it as far as like the knowledge and the theory. The theory is patient first, primum non nocere, first do no harm. And you always have to think through those very basic skill set. And if whatever's right for the patient is what we do, and we do that within the realm of safety, because some docs get into this very slippery, slopish thing of the patient tells me they're happy, so it must be the right thing for the patient. And that's how they end up with patients on high-dose opioids and benzos and stuff like that. The right thing for the patient many times requires conflict. And so understanding that our path is one that is conflict and conflict and resolution, and then eventually you get to more resolution days than conflict days, and then you start having to fight to get something, and then you're both on the same team. But we have a new doctor that started today, so we'll see. We're going to do a randomized controlled trial of this intervention where I will not touch a patient, honestly, and Shelly's going to be involved with seeing some of the patients from a behavioral health standpoint, but we're going to check the system because we have to know. I mean, that was the reality at the beginning of this is, if it doesn't work, then I quit. I mean, honestly, if it doesn't, then I don't want to waste another dollar, because the whole point of this was to develop a system that we use less dollars to deliver better care, to help patients. And if it's not doing that, then what I don't want it to be is just another stamp of something that we have to do because we feel that we have to because somebody had a lot of passion behind it. And so we're going to take a very hard look at this, and if it doesn't work, then I will be the first one to advocate that we close it. And I think that that's what we have to start doing with a lot of our interventions is to look at it. But we think so. At this point, we've boxed all the information. We've gotten funding from Robert Wood Johnson to build an online training curricula that'll have all of the pieces of knowledge we think you need to do this job. It's all built through archetypal patients at multiple stages within their lives. So it's not just, I'm gonna give you a lecture about bipolar. You know, we're gonna talk about Tobin, and we're gonna talk about how Tobin grew up and what he looked like in his early life and why he died, before he got to later in life, and how we would evaluate and treat bipolar in Tobin's life. And that's how we're gonna learn it, because that's how we learned it. You know, we have all these patients are real people.
And we can teach the skill set to anybody, but it's having the passion for the population, which is key. You have to really want to work with this really chronic population that yells at you and swears at you and fires you and has some really bad behaviors, for lack of a better word. I mean, it has to be a passion you have, and it has to be, and also being a part of a multidisciplinary team. as well, because that in and of itself is challenging at times.
It is, and I think that you have to sometimes, when you don't have the answer, you have to defer to somebody else's answer. And that's not always easy, because passion for this group a lot of times goes with strong-headedness as a base, and on all sides, including even our MAs. I remember when I first started having basically an argument with an MA that was about, the MA was telling me that I should not send in the refill of the medication, or the patient wasn't going to show up for their visit the next day. And this is when I first started, and I'm like, why are you telling me to not prescribe? I mean, just send it in. We'll deal with it tomorrow. And what'd they do? Not show up. And so everybody has the capability to give you information that's really helpful. And that's actually one of the hardest, that is the hardest skill set. Because we can teach you how to, what the evidence base is and how to approach it, like Shelly said. But if you're not curious when you see a chronically ill patient, if you're not really excitedly interested when you're maybe finding a disease that nobody else diagnosed. Like, I was happy for a week when we diagnosed Ehlers-Danlos in a patient who had been misdiagnosed with osteogenesis imperfecta.
Who also has a really bad SUD.
And significant cluster B. And just fired us.
Again.
After her post-op thing. She'll be back. But if you don't get excited about that stuff, so when you recruit to develop systems of care, that becomes really one of the most important aspects in recruiting is, do you like these patients? And if the answer is, I've figured out how to deal with them, that's not it. You're going to fail, and it's going to really be bad for them. It's going to be like a bad failure, because you're going to fight because you have, you want to do good and you want to do these things, but just wanting to see them and fighting through that is no different. That is just not going to cut it for emotionally feeling connected to this group of people and how you need to improve their life. Because if you don't hear from a patient that they were treated poorly in the hospital and it takes two other staff members to keep you from driving in your car to the hospital and throwing a beat down to some surgeon in the hallway, then quite honestly, you're not built for this. I mean, it's not okay. We tell our patients, if you're at the hospital and you're treated poorly, I need to know that, because that's not okay. And you need to, because they cannot advocate for themselves. And so you have to be a very strong advocate. But you also need to know your skill set really well, because people will challenge you. Other people in white coats will challenge you all day long.
So let's be specific about recruiting. I was at a family meal, and my brother was saying he was getting interviewed for an inner city teaching job, and it was a panel interview, and one guy suddenly looked at him and said, "Fuck you, Baldy, you're full of shit." And my brother looked, stepped aside, and my dad looked, and he said, "I would have walked out." And we said, "That's why my father will never work in a school like that." So then my brother, of course, said, "I assume you're yelling at me to see if I react, and if I don't react, I could teach here. But do you use any particular recruiting techniques to wean out people like my father who wouldn't make it and people like my brother who could stick around?"
It's not much different, actually.
Yeah.
I see how many F-bombs I can drop in an interview before somebody's just like, "This guy is weird." I mean, honestly, and I was having this conversation at lunch very specifically about, how we interview people, because at first I interviewed for the 20 years experience and all of those things that we talked about and found that, that's great if it was also built with around these patients. But, on a daily basis, I use a therapeutic F-bomb, with a patient. And I never thought that I would be able to actually drop that in with seeing a patient and have that be substantively positive for outcomes. So I know I found the Rourke, especially after Philly, when that was like every other word. You have to, when you see them, they have to be able to deal with that. So I will hammer them with questions I know they do not know the answer to. Because I want to have somebody go, I don't know that, but I'm willing to learn that. I don't know that. But if they make up some bull crap, then that's trouble, because patients are going to ask you questions. And like I said, earlier, wrong words are, it's like wrong medicine. And so if you don't know, say that you don't know, and that somebody else would be better to answer that question. And so they need to be able to resolve conflict. And so you bring up times. Tell me the time in which you knew you were right but didn't have the power to let other people know it. And what did you do? And, those types of things are important. And if they're like, "Well, I was mad because they wanted to sell me a new tire and I didn't," I'm like, is that like the pinnacle of your conflict in life? Because that's like the person who says, "I have a high pain tolerance," but they've never had a painful event. I'm like, really? I like thump them on the ear and they cry on the floor, So they really have to have a little bit of battle testing. And so this is why we end up hiring social workers who generally have rotated through our clinic. Because during
not as patients.
Yeah, not as patients, yeah. We have had that request a couple of times. But it's great when patients say, you know, I want to come work here. We get that a lot, actually, and that's pretty interesting. But at the same time, you have to have someone who knows boundaries. So you have to say, so let's say you have a patient that you know just spent the copay money that we all scraped together out of our little copay bucket, you know, that we'll use every now and then, because we know that the risk of not getting the medication is much higher than the benefit of trying to have them work through it themselves, which we do long term. So this is never something we do all the time. But let's say they spent that on alcohol. What do you do with that patient who you know needs that medication? I think that, you know, so that's a tough question, right? How much is enough? And if it's somebody who's not in the direct treatment pathway, what I want them to say is, you know, I would ask the provider. And that's an okay thing for my medical assistant, for hiring medical assistants to answer that question. If it's a therapist and you say, I have a patient who needs a ride, even though they could find a ride, needs a ride, and it's, you know, kind of a pain for you, are you going to give them a ride? And if they call you in crisis, are you going to answer the phone the seventh time that they call you on a Saturday night, even though you know it's a manufactured crisis? You need to get an answer of, you know, well, I'll probably give them a ride if it's something that's going to be therapeutically available. But if they can figure out a way, that's always the first time that we would, you know, the first pathway. And then somebody who's going to say, you know what? No, I'm not going to answer the phone the seventh time because I know it's not helpful at this point. They're just spinning up and I'm just causing that, you know, to be different. But there are a lot of boundary issues that come up with, we become emotionally connected to some of these patients. And I had that early. Absolutely. I've had a few that I started them on some medications that now I would never start a patient on, but it was just early in the career of addiction and pain and all of those things together. And I almost felt guilty and I wouldn't take them off. And I knew that everybody else in the clinic was like, what are you doing? Like, there's nobody else that you're doing this for. And he's like playing you like a fiddle. And I knew it. I wasn't deaf to the fact that I was totally being played like a fiddle, that it was somebody else's urine, you know, that like all of these things. But I had also gotten him on these medications. And so it was really, really hard to know as soon as I stopped him, he was going to leave. And he did. And he's using again. But that's a boundary issue because you can't save everybody. And that's a hard thing because people in this field want to save everybody. And so you have to really create that hard boundary of what would I have done differently to prevent that situation from happening again, but not, you know, I'm willing to go back and do it again just so I can get them, you know, off the street. I'm not going to commit a felony and write somebody for methadone pills when I know they need a methadone clinic. You know, but and having that boundary as a prescriber becomes really important. And it's like being a firefighter or a paramedic and knowing that you have downed wires and the car's there. I mean, it doesn't, you wait. You have to, and it sucks. When I was a paramedic, that was really frustrating, you know, those types of calls. I mean, that's a part of it, but you have to wait. If you have gunshots, you have to sit in the car, you know, sit in the bus until they show up, and then you get off after the cops come. And you really have to make sure that we check each other on that. And I think from a boundary standpoint, you really do have to have that open conversation of, you know what, are you doing what you're doing for that patient because it's the medical necessity of what you're doing, or are you doing it to make you feel better? And be able to answer that question without biting, you know, somebody's head off over time.
So let's talk a little bit about safety, because there are a couple questions about how do you ensure safety for your staff? What if someone's become, even with a trauma-informed environment, they become verbally abusive or a threat of physical abuse? Do you put people on behavioral contracts? Do you ever deny service until people calm down? You want to take that, Shelly?
Sure. So, like I said, anyone who comes in gets de-escalation training. We haven't had anyone actually get violent towards staff. We have a lot, like swearing at staff, that's kind of normal. I mean, behavior is a symptom, and our patients come in and they're all jacked up. I mean, they don't come in recovery if they have an addiction disorder. They don't come in with a well-treated mental illness. They don't come in with really well-treated pain. If all those things were occurring, then they wouldn't be in the clinic. So we have patients who, for lack of a better word, are a big hot mess because they have a multitude of problems, not only physical and behavioral health problems, but social determinants that exacerbate that. So we expect them to come in with bad behavior. We have had patients come in, and I think the worst was threatened to blow us up. You know, and we, I should say, Corey here, actually talked with a patient and told her that wasn't okay, it was inappropriate, and she never did it again.
Yeah, so a lot of this is also as physician lead. And many mm-hmm. times in the emergency department when I was seeing, you know, somebody would get violent, the physician would kind of leave the area and let others take care of it. You know, I'm the son of a Force Recon Marine, so that was never something I was really trained to do. So if you have to defend your staff as the leader of that ship, and that means you have to confront the patient about behavior that's not okay, and that includes, you know, how they interact with people at the front, other patients out in the front, any other staff. And it's interesting how rapidly they'll de-escalate when you walk in the room and you physically look angry and you say, "The fuck do you think you are? Come in my clinic that does nothing but try to help you, and all you do is yell at my staff." I mean, that's actually the tone that we would use. I mean, they haven't had that parenteral feedback. And so this is behavior mod 101. They're pushing the boundary. You have to set the boundary in a hard way. Before I actually came to the clinic, I was getting pretty consistent death threats because I was cutting people off in the emergency department as an ER physician and setting up these things. And I had an average about one written a month and a bunch of verbals. And I mean, that was just kind of steady as she went. It was just a part of the gig. And that's completely gone in the clinic. And now we're actually what would be considered a city safe site because our patients are like, this place is off limits. And we've all gang activity is scooted out circumferentially around from our place. We don't have people selling dope where we used to right next to it. Yeah.
I laugh because one of Corey's bad days in the office, so one of the IT guys hosed his computer big time. Yeah. And so instead of like shanking the IT guy, he chose to go outside and lay into one of the crack dealers that was on the corner.
Yeah.
So social work went out and kind of reeled him back in before he got shanked.
He never came back, though.
No, he didn't.
He did. I was like, this is my fucking block.
But, so, see. Yeah. That is a true statement.
Yeah.
So safety is a big issue. And so the rule is, if you don't feel safe, then you need to let someone know.
Yeah.
So if our MAs don't feel safe with a patient or the front desk doesn't feel safe, they just need to let us know. There's always social work there. We have security on site, which helps a lot for our patients that will escalate. But that's the biggest thing. And
we do have an egress plan. So we actually have, you know, multi-set locking doors. We have a barricade that is open visually with glass. And it's not even really, like, it's not bulletproof glass or anything like that. It's just a normal HIPAA kind of compliant, you know, front end to the office so that we can have it. But it also has a badge-controlled door followed by a badge-controlled door, so it's almost like you have this inner space, you know, that they can go. We do have an egress plan, and we've gone through these things. So there are practical things that we've gone through because we are the highest-risk place in our system other than the emergency department for something violent to have. So you can't be naive to it. You can have all the training in the world, but it's mental illness. And if somebody is SPMI and they have schizophrenia and they've missed their meds and they've just used cocaine, you don't know what's in their brain or what they see me as. So you can have all the de-escalation you want, but in that setting, it's not going to help. So, you know, we do have very practical approaches to this in the sense that we have a de-escalation plan out front, which is basically a stall pathway so patients can get back out the front, or we can shuttle them through the clinic, and then we have a rear exit at the building that we can then collapse into a center hallway and out. So we do have an actual egress plan. We have buttons in the therapy rooms that will immediately get everybody to the room, and you know, we have them set up so that you're always back to the door, you know, the very basic things that you do for safety. If a person is escalated, then we'll have the security guy stand outside of the door, maybe a couple of doors down, and we'll go in with two people so that, you know, for working on the de-escalation. And so, I mean, there are practical things that we do as well, and I think those are pretty standard in behavioral health you know, places. But at the same time, it is, if you treat them well and you just set your boundaries appropriately, it mitigates a lot of that.
So I think the biggest problem is our patients getting abusive on the phone.
Yeah.
I mean, our patients are the ones who call the office 50 times a day, and that's true. They actually do call 50 times. Some of them do. But they'll get really abusive and verbally violent on the phone, and that becomes more of an issue. And I almost think that that's harder for our staff to handle, the MAs. In the front desk, because when they're verbally aggressive in the office, for some reason it's easier for them to deal with, but on the phone it is. So our staff has the ability to hang up on people, just say, I don't have to listen to this and I'm hanging up now, or transfer them to social work. Usually they hang up by the time someone picks up the phone.
And then they also, you know, the physician again has to take also a role in kind of stopping that behavior. Mm-hmm. We used to do that really early, and for some reason recently I don't notice that happening as often, where I'm getting calls. But our girls that are our MAs, it's amazing. I remember when they first started, because we've had them both for over 2 years now, and it's pretty amazing, because they'll sit there and they'll just nod and de-escalate, and then all of a sudden the patient is just kind of sitting in the chair waiting for their appointment. And whereas before they would come back and almost be crying a little bit, and we'd have to kind of emotionally help them step back and relax, they're rock stars now. I mean, it's amazing what they can take.
That also goes back to staffing, though. So when you're looking at staffing for a clinic like this, it doesn't just go to the behavioral health and the medical providers, like really having a passion for working with this population, but it also goes to the front desk staff, the MA. I mean, if we could afford to have a BSW at the front desk, that would be awesome. But our MAs are not your typical MAs. I mean, they're the ones that would probably at this point not do well in primary care. But like Crystal in particular, she always had an issue in primary care just because of her mannerism and presentation. But she's awesome with the patients.
Yeah. Yeah, we hire the atypical ones, you're right.
Yeah.
I mean, so I love it when HR gives me a heads up. I mean, that's also something. I don't know if this person is going to be right. I'm like, oh, we want to see them first. Yeah. Because what will happen is sometimes their interaction style is too gruff, which actually works relatively well with our patients because it's very matter of fact. But also there are times in which they're frustrated with something not working better and they just want to make it better. And because we're ICS is kind of an agile innovation shop as well, everybody has their own capability to change their whole pathway. They don't need my permission to change how they do things. And they can change it and just present it to me how they've done it. And I think that is something in this space you really need, because you have to have somebody who feels like they can control their own environment as well.
So I'm just going to go through this quick. This is a test that, like a true testimony to the quality and just the ability to care for this patient population in our office. And this goes to our staff, and this is actually has nothing to do with Corey or me. We have a patient who is a diagnosed schizophrenic, involved with case management with CMH. Case management can't seem to get this schizophrenic who has a substance use disorder to make his scheduled appointments, which I don't know why, because all schizophrenics keep scheduled appointments. When he injects, he usually injects in his neck or his arms, but his neck is cleaner than his arms. But he comes in regularly and came in last week and said, he's on risperidol injections, and came in last week and said, I think it's time for my injections again because the voices are starting to get really bad. Now, case management can't seem to find this guy, but he's in our office like 3 days a week.
Yeah.
So we're going to go till about 6 o'clock Michigan time, which would be 3 o'clock our time. Then we're going to take a little break. And then the rest of the afternoon, we'll do a mix of questions by cards and questions from the audience. I just know when I visited you, I found this format of learning was really engaging and helpful to kind of go question by question. So that's why we're doing it today. One of the things that Kat was asked, and we had a discussion about this at lunch, is you had said that 90% of the time when you put addiction treatment in primary care, it fails, but it's easier to put primary care methadone clinics. And the question is, do you think, you know, why is that? And do you think that has to do with the environment in Michigan? Is it because you don't have really robust FQHCs? So if you could talk a little bit about that bi-directional integration and the pluses and minuses of integrating one way or versus the other.
Yeah, and so it's not just that comment's not informed purely based on Michigan. I've been in, I guess now, probably 20 different states and kind of worked through some of these systems, you know, in each of those states. And when we start to look at that, what I think is the crux of it is picking the wrong primary care. So what you'll do is you'll pick a primary care office based on one doctor out of the six physicians in that place that wants to see these patients, with them not realizing that the front desk staff has to room patients for all of those physicians. And unless you have an entire medical staff on board, you know, with this, it just is not going to work. So I think when you start shoving that square peg in the round hole of the one doc or maybe two out of the six in those medical homes that want it but the other ones don't, then what you get are very quiet conversations to their own staff and their MAs about how frustrated they are about that person, and then it creates a ton of chaos and infighting. Very, very human capital management problems, you know, HR stuff all day long. So that's a big issue. And the other is, I don't think anybody really asks, do you want to treat these patients? I think they come up with a really good idea. And we've done this in Spectrum as well, where we're like, we're going to integrate behavioral therapy into all of our primary care offices. There's really good data to show that's not smart monetarily, but we're not, you know, higher ups feel like it's a great idea despite being told that there's no data for that unless you can identify a disease burden within that population that allows for you to have appropriate referrals to them and screenings and all of that. But when we do that, at first we chose the first office, but then all of a sudden we're going to ramp it up, and then we're not appropriately choosing the other offices. And when I say appropriately choosing, nobody asked. Nobody did like a survey of the staff. Just sent out a basic 3-question survey. Do you feel like you have all the information you need to know about how to treat an addiction patient? Do you really want to, you know, enhance your capability to treat this population, therefore increasing probably the number of people here with it? I mean, I think if they at least asked it, it would make a much more informed pathway for how to onboard it. Because there are some things when you have a health system where you own physicians and you pay them, you just kind of get to tell them. I mean, there's some things where that's a reality of where we're going in medicine, and not everything is totally a choice. There's some things we just have to do. But it's nice to at least know where you start. And I think from an HR standpoint, we haven't done a good job in most healthcare facilities, in any that I can find, quite honestly, that really engages staff to find early barriers to implementation of these pathways, as far as just a QA or focus groups or those things that have really been shown to be helpful. And I think that should be really step one, is why are we already doing it? Because there's a reason. I mean, there's absolutely a reason that this isn't onboarded. We got guidelines, we got all this other stuff, we know it's a disease, all the primary docs I talk to are angry that they don't have enough help with this stuff and they want to do it. But do they really, and what is it that they want to do? Do they just want to get the patient to not come in and ask for opioids? Or do they really want to treat the disease of addiction? Or do they want to have the ability to hand it off faster? We don't really know what they want. So I think a lot of it has to do with, we're not asking the right questions prior to just trying to onboard a lot of this stuff into primary care. And quite honestly, again, it's an understanding that unless you've worked in community mental health, I mean, it took me a few years of working in CMH and PHPs and to even know what those words meant, you know, a CA versus a PHP versus this, and what is an 1115 waiver, and, you know, to know what that means and what the carve-out is. All of those are really specialty knowledge areas that don't exist in mainstream medicine. So in mainstream medicine, I finish my chart and somebody bills it and it gets paid, or it doesn't. I don't care because I just keep seeing patients. I mean, and that's a whole different concept, and you have to really start to have payer-informed billing mechanisms. Like, is this a patient who's I'm going to be able to actually get buprenorphine for, or do I have to give them the Zubsolve ticket so they can get 2 weeks of it because it's going to take me forever to get a prior auth through Medicare as compared to this? I mean, that's a whole different pathway of frustration, but once you understand it, it's not a big deal. It's not perfect putting a primary care doctor in a methadone clinic either. It's just easier from that standpoint because their job is still just to handle the thing that they're comfortable with, which is the physical health aspects of these patients. But they still need training and understanding is what are the most common physical aspects that you need to treat in this population, because you wouldn't normally have to look for liver failure in a 24-year-old. You know, but these are really common things. You wouldn't necessarily have to do STD checks on your 54-year-old. But if she's a crack cocaine addict, you need to do that almost every time they come in, even if it's just a urine GC chlamydia. You wouldn't normally have to ask how often do they sell themselves for drugs, so that you would know what their risk is, and do you do an IUD versus, you know, implantable stuff. I mean, so it becomes a different vernacular and conversation with the patient, but you need to have that conversation with an unwavering tone. So when I ask somebody if they've used drugs, I don't just ask, have you ever used opioids? I'm like, so at what age did you start using, you know, opioids like Norco and stuff like that? And it's not if or when, I just ask if. And then when they do, I go, so when you started, were you just taking it orally, or did you chew it, or did you snort it, or did you inject it? In that tone, just like I'm asking about their blood pressure. Did they check it in the morning or the afternoon or the later of the day? And then I went to heroin, and I'm like, okay, well, did you smoke the heroin? Did you snort the heroin, or did you inject the heroin? And it's predictable that they'll say, I started by snorting, or I started, you know, smoking. And I go, well, so now are you on you know, China white or brown sugar or black tar? I mean, it's a conversation. And so it requires a new vernacular to be able to have a really accurate conversation with patients. And I think we can train that. I mean, I think that that's an ability to train. But if a doctor is going to be watching for bacteremia in a patient, in an IV drug user with a fever, it's a whole different workup than your URI workup in a primary care office. We have to draw blood cultures. We have to do a really good, thorough cardiac exam and may even send them for an echocardiogram for a 23-year-old with a fever. I mean, these are just a whole different thought process of workup for these patients as compared to others. So it's not like it's just a perfect, easy, oh, just drop a family med doctor in, it's all good. It's not. I mean, you have to really train them up on some of these other packages. And I would say the perfect addiction medicine physician is a family medicine doctor with training in pain and board certified in addiction. I mean, that's, I think, really the perfect person for that. Or, you know, a nurse practitioner who's trained in the same stuff who, you know, has to do it. I think we can do that with a nurse practitioner or a PA and a physician helping. But I think that as we look at these things, both require onboarding of new knowledge and a new thought process, because you can't have a primary care doctor who's against medication-assisted treatment that you drop in a methadone clinic. Because they're going to be like, you know, you're not really clean unless you're off all your meds. And thank you. And I'm going to wait for you in the parking lot. And these are things. It only takes one comment like that because, you know, patients, not unlike police officers, always regress to their lowest level of training. So if you look at in California, you guys should be aware of this. So back in the 80s when you guys had this huge shootout at the bank, and that's where kind of SWAT, it was in LA, and that's kind of when SWAT came about and really started intervening because the police were outgunned. The thing that we pulled from that, from a training modality, is when you watch that, there were four police officers who, when they ran out of ammo in their pistol, put their gun down on their car and raised their hands for about a 5-second period of time and then went, ugh, and then, like, you know, ducked. Four, not one, four. And we look at this and we're like, what in the world is that? Well, come to find out, when they were actually doing firearms training, that was the drill that they did on the line at their lowest level of training, which is firing on the line. When their gun was empty, they were to put their weapon down and raise their hands so that the shoot instructor knew that they were empty. So in that moment of crisis, everybody regresses to their lowest level of training. So for our patients, it's the same thing. And so if we've trained them only to a certain level and they have a crisis in their life, emotionally, they will regress to their lowest level of training, not their highest level of training. So the expectations that we put on our patients are pretty hard, you know, because these are the same expectations we hold of ourselves, who we're pretty trained. Our lowest level of training, like as an ER doc who trained in Philly, I don't get rattled. I just don't. I mean, it's just like that's the lowest level of training is you have three patients, all of which have about a 7-minute window of life death figured out. I mean, and those were my days in Cooper trauma, when the trauma surgeon was already upstairs operating along with the senior surgical staff, and I'm a third-year EM resident standing there deciding those things. And if that's your lowest level of training, then that's good. So you just don't panic. But if your lowest level of training, you know, is just showing up and watching a 30-minute video, that's what you regress to emotionally and physically. So, you know, as we look at all of these pathways for patients, we shouldn't expect anything but them from their lowest level of training. And that lowest level of training with no parents, early drug use disorder, and all of those things is pretty low.